Entrepreneurial Edge is brought to you by Business Banking from FNB, because small ideas can lead to big business. FNB, how can we help you?
Back in 1993, a group of young and really passionate entrepreneurs started this organization providing internet access to primarily the corporates in South Africa. And over time, just grown substantially since then. We've moved into providing VPN services, managing very large networks on behalf of our clients, managing the security around it, providing hosting services. So a whole range of services, really out of just an idea of providing internet access to the corporate market way back then, 18 years ago. Internet solutions, I think, primarily is really around utilizing the technology that we have available to us to make the world a better place. And if that's through ensuring that organizations are able to trade more effectively, to try and take certain initiatives like e-learning out to areas where they previously didn't have those advantages, just finding ways and interesting and innovative ways of using this technology in such a manner that just generally people have the ability to communicate a whole lot better with one another. So I recall when I started, I was employee number 46, I think. We're now sitting at 1300. We've got presence obviously throughout South Africa, Joburg, Durban, Cape Town, Port Elizabeth, East London, Pretoria. And we've also started going into Africa as well. We've acquired organizations in Nigeria, in Kenya, in Ghana, Mozambique. We've got some significant plans to roll out into upwards of 6 additional territories into Africa. So it's grown tremendously. I mean, it's been an absolute privilege to be part of this team of passionate individuals. It's really quite an amazing journey and quite an amazing story. It's by no means the end.
Okay, now in the studio, we've got the man himself, Ronnie Apteker. And now, Ronnie, what gave you the idea to become Africa's first internet provider?
Well, that sounds very glamorous, and it sounds like there was a big vision. The truth of the matter is, I was a student at Wits, and I was friends and studying with some very bright guys, and we were writing software from Wits, and it became quite apparent that we could write more software if we were networked, if we could sit in one location and be connected to a whole bunch of IT centers. We could write software for many different companies without having to get in your car. And that's where the idea came from, for building like a distributed system. And then what became quite apparent is that it wasn't just IT companies that needed help, from IBM and ICL, et cetera, and Microsoft, that banks, insurance companies, retailers all have IT departments. And it became quite clear that they all had software requirements and development challenges. And this community of online resources grew, and it keeps growing. It's actually quite overwhelming how fast it grows.
So what were the humble beginnings for you and your colleagues when you first started out? I mean, what did you literally do?
Well, we were in a small office in Randburg, and I was doing what I'm doing now with the movie. I was phoning and begging people. The difference then is that everyone was very intrigued by this new frontier and the internet and this new technology. And it became quite clear after a few years, by 95, 96, especially today, that this is a necessity. It's not a nice to have. Making a film, on the other hand, is an over-traded space. There's no need for another film. People love a good film, but good films are rare. And magical films are rare. So now I'm begging people, and it's a nice to have. Whereas in those days, what started off as a novelty became very soon, in a few years, something that was an absolute necessity and mission critical. And it really was about who did the best job and who was the better salesperson and who had the best technology. You didn't have to convince people on buying the technology. You had to convince them on your company and your way of doing business. Whereas the movie, wow, it's an uphill battle.
So one thing I've got to ask you, we're going to talk a lot more about the movies in the second half, which is your next life as an entrepreneur, as it were. Wow. But when you first started out, what was it like when you had to try and sell something that no one actually knew really what it was?
It's a great question. And I used to tell people it's like being called and saying, I've heard about this driving thing, but I'm not sure how to drive. In fact, people would first say, why should I drive? So you'd spend a whole bunch of time explaining to people why they should use the internet. You're not talking about your company or what you have to offer, just like public service. Why, you know, imagine going into Sandown Motors around the corner and saying, I've heard about this driving thing, please can someone spend an hour teaching me why driving is good. They'll throw you, they'll call the oaks in the white jackets. You know, then if you get through that, they'll say, okay, I'm convinced, now teach me how to drive. And then they'll say, now teach me or tell me why your car is the right car. You know, this is what we had to go through. And it was very funny, and it was entertaining, but it was quite frustrating.
What were some of the funniest things that people said to you in those days when no one knew what the internet was?
Well, that's a great question. The terminology, like I've emailed like Bill Clinton and he's not mailing me back. You know, what's up? The internet doesn't work. Or I get emails saying the internet's broken. I'd mail back saying, how long has it been broken for? They said, well, nothing works. And I'd mail back saying, but you're emailing me. What exactly is broken? And they go, you know, and people would phone us up and say they want to buy the internet. In fact, they wouldn't say the word the. They'd say, I want to buy internet. You know, and then when they got a bit more of the terminology, they want to buy the internet. I said, you want to buy the whole thing? I mean, it's going to cost a fortune, you know? So they didn't really understand. And you couldn't make fun of people. And I think that's what we did so well. We laughed with them. We didn't laugh at them. And we said, sir, ma'am, let me try and explain it, you know? And we had a lot of fun with it. But it had its challenges, and one had to keep a cool head. But we used to get all kinds of things like, you know, before people had the internet, they didn't use their computers nearly as much. Probably people didn't have computers nearly as much. But then suddenly they get the internet and they start downloading a whole bunch of porn. And the hard drive fills up. So we would get blamed for that. When somebody's husband or wife left them, they said, it's because of you guys. We'd get blamed for that. You know, you know. So since before the internet, we didn't have these problems. I said, well, we didn't do that. You know.
But were there many people in those days? I mean, we're going way back to 93, 94, who said, look, I'm sorry. I don't want it. I'm not going to
use
it.
We were told that a lot.
Really?
Yeah. People said it's a waste of time. It's a novelty. It's a phase. You know, and we persisted. You know, they said luck favors the persistent. And I'm a bit of a bulldog. I didn't let go. So when someone said that, I didn't take it personally. You know, 6 months later, you know, three days later, 3 hours later, this internet story was like all pervasive. And every publication in the world was covering it. You couldn't like not be exposed to the early days of the internet.
So when people, what sort of tricks did you have to pull sometimes to convince people to buy what you were selling?
You had to beg, you know, it's something I obviously have excelled in. But it's not a glamorous title. But you know, you had to persist, you had to be graceful, you had to believe in what you're doing, you had to show people magic, you know. You know, what's magical is if I took a photograph of us now, and whip out my computer and transfer it to it in a second, and then a minute later it's at my friend in New York. That's magic. To my parents, it's still a magic trick. Yeah. That's quite amazing. In the old days, you used to go to the chemist and get your photos developed, and they'd look all brown and come in an envelope. And then if you traveled, if somebody went overseas, you'd go to the airport and wave the plane goodbye, and everyone would clap when the plane lands, and you'd have the photos in your bag and you'd hand them over. Now I can take a picture in the most incredible high definition quality, and within less than a minute, it's sitting at a friend in America. Of the two of us here, that's a magic trick, you know?
Do you think, as an entrepreneur, that because it's so pervasive now and everyone's doing it, as I say, a child of six can get a cell phone and send anything you like, that it's kind of saturated, you think, the market? Or do you think it's only just beginning?
I think the market is saturated in one level, is that there are so many options to get onto the internet. But I think it's just the beginning in terms of how the internet is influencing our daily routine and our behavior and our shopping patterns and our social interactions. I mean, a fantastic statistic is that they say that one out of two people in America that are getting married are meeting on the internet, are meeting online. They don't use the word, they don't use the word internet anymore. They say they're meeting online, you know, which is incredible. You know, it's 20 years ago, where was that statistic? 50% of America is getting connected literally, physically, and romantically on the internet. I think a more interesting statistic is I think like probably 30% of those people are also getting divorced because of the internet. Because they go into something like Facebook, and which should be called Flirtbook. You know, in my opinion, it's mainly for married people that are looking for trouble. But you know, and they go into Facebook and they end up having an affair. So they meet someone online, but then they also meet someone else online. So it's, you know, it's extraordinary either way you look at it. But it's a phenomenon, and you can't say that it's a fad or a or like a passing phase. It's huge.
So back to your early days, what about the banks? I mean, you must have had a problem going to the banks at that stage and saying, listen, there's something that you may have read about in the magazines, but it doesn't really exist yet. Yeah. We want to invest heavily in it. Will you lend us some money? What were they saying to you?
Well, you know, that's a brilliant question, because nobody did lend us any money. You know, we bootstrapped any capital we had. We worked, made some money, reinvested it. And it started off very modestly, and it still is, in my opinion, and a humble business. But it's a big business, but there's nothing, there's no extravagances there in from what I can, you know, tell you. But we didn't know, you know, we didn't go to a bank. We went to all the banks, but we asked them to take a chance on us. To take a chance on us as opposed to taking a chance on IBM. And IBM's a brilliant business. It's a global giant that's been around forever, but we didn't have credibility like IBM or any of the other big, you know, IT businesses, and you know, back then, Unisys, ICL, there were so many brands that have gone, you know, from Wellfleet to Ungerman Bus. You don't know these brands anymore, but Microsoft, IBM, etc. Those were the people that we were up against. They said, "You want okay, connecting the internet is one thing, but you want us to develop online banking with a bunch of students, you know, unknowns, no credibility. This is not just a fun and games thing. This is serious. People's money. It's like hospitals and banks. Very serious about what goes on. If something goes wrong, people die. You know, imagine waking up, you log on, your money's gone, you have a heart attack. You know, it's like a hospital. You can't afford for things to go wrong, and it's a very serious space." And yeah.
Ronnie Apteker, one of the founders of Internet Solutions, the first internet provider in Africa. We're going to talk a lot more in the second half about your business and also your new life as an entrepreneur, as a movie mogul or budding movie mogul. We'll talk about that. It's time for a short ad break now. We'll see you right after this.